In addition to assessing cognitive impairment, it's also important to assess depression as well. And why is that? Because it's a common contributor to impaired cognitive function in older adults. We find that cognitive function improves, in fact, as depression goes down. Therefore, it's very good to find out, is the patient depressed? And if so, how severe is it? So for assessment, we can recommend some commonly used measures that are available in Spanish as well as in English. The Geriatric Depression Scale, the Beck Depression Inventory 2, and the PHQ-9, or the Patient Health Questionnaire. So why is depression important in the primary care setting? Because almost 50% of patients who are detected to be depressed and who are treated for depression, it occurs in the primary care setting, not in the psychiatry or mental health setting. Depression complicates the treatment of other common medical problems: heart disease, diabetes, stroke prevention. Depression can make it more difficult for the person to comply with instructions, to take their medications, and it can really lead to a vicious cycle. The more depressed the person becomes, oftentimes the poorer their self-perceived health. Not all patients, even when they are effectively treated, whether it's in primary care settings or in mental health settings, achieve remission or a complete decrease of their depression. Rather, many achieve only a partial improvement. But better systems of detection and care will increase the rate of people who do actually achieve remission from their depressive disorder.
If you look down at the bottom of that slide, you will see the website that you can go to, where you can download in many languages the Geriatric Depression Scale, including a number of Spanish translations, again regionally based. It is free and not copyright protected. The Beck Depression Inventory has been revised. There's a BDI-2 that's available in English and Spanish, but at present not in any other languages. And it is has to be purchased from the Psychological Corporation. Now, some of the pros and cons: the GDS does not assess traditional symptoms of depression. It focuses more on the psychological aspects, such as not feeling good about yourself, pessimism towards the future, feeling hopeless and helpless. The BDI, on the other hand, the BDI-2 was specifically developed to tap into the symptoms of depression that are used in the DSM-4 diagnostic system of classification. So it asks about sleep disturbance, appetite, energy, etc. So depending upon your needs, you might want to use one or the other, depending if you do any other type of assessment for depression. The GDS, though, does have one particular thing that I want to mention to recommend it, which makes it usable for individuals even with mild cognitive impairment, and that is it's a simple response format: yes, no. Some people say, well, that's too gross. You know, they don't really, they can't quite decide yes or no, and they want to say in between, and they could write in an answer like that if they wished. But generally speaking, it's yes, no, so that makes it easier, whereas the BDI, virtually every item has four response choices, so the person has to read all of them and then make a decision, and it's been found not to be accurate with people with cognitive impairment.
The Patient Health Questionnaire, or PHQ-9, is a validated screening tool that has been used with all age groups and many different ethnic and cultural groups. The scoring parallels the DSM system for diagnosis of major and minor depressive disorders, and therefore it can be very helpful in mental health settings as well as in primary care. It's quick to administer, can be done in person or over the phone, and it's generally done before the individual sees their clinician, so that when they see that clinician, the person has an idea whether depression is present or not, if further questions should be made, and the severity of the condition. So on their website and in their printed materials, the developers of the PHQ-9 recommend a technique called watchful waiting for those whose scores are not in a severely depressed range. This would apply if you're going to see the patient approximately once every month, if you are able to continue to administer the PHQ-9 and monitor the score. You don't start active treatment. Instead, what you do is you recommend self-care activities such as exercise or relaxation training or a self-help book on depression. And you watchfully wait and reassess. So if the symptoms are still persistent and high after about a 3-month period has elapsed, then you would initiate active treatment, medication, psychotherapy, or both.
So what do you do next if the screening suggests that there is cognitive impairment? Well, the first item there, the first bullet point, talks about the neurology department at Stanford, which has a memory clinic that provides a comprehensive evaluation and that uses trained interpreters for individuals where English is not their primary language. There's a similar program at UCSF, University of California at San Francisco, and I'm sure at other major medical centers as well. Those just happen to be the two that I'm most familiar with. Throughout California, there are Alzheimer's disease centers that exist, although they have been severely affected by budget cuts recently. But they do provide diagnostic workups for individuals with suspected dementia. However, there are certain eligibility criteria, and English is the preferred language at most of them. So I recommend, actually, for the most up-to-date information about options that you might have in your region for getting a more comprehensive evaluation of the person, not just stopping with the screening, you really should consult your local Alzheimer's Association office. They maintain up-to-date lists of practitioners, of centers, of departments in medical centers that can provide that service, and that will save you a lot of time compared to just trying to find out those things by having to make multiple phone calls.